Declan, so nice to have this opportunity to have this conversation. I think it's a really important conversation. We're going to talk a little bit about this book and your 12 principles of ecological settlement design and how they're so deeply relevant now, where people are almost monthly asking me the question, this whole regenerative culture thing, how would that look in a city and how would we transform our cities so they're actually regenerating human and ecosystems health and regenerating social cohesion and more civic participation. And to start off with, I would love to hear how did this book came about, because this is from the mid 90s. It was a European project, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was a European project of the European Association of the Urban Environment and the Academy, I'm sorry. And this Academy was in Berlin, West Berlin. And we had been working with them on an off basis. Mm-hmm. And then they gave us this idea of getting different people together who were talking on different levels about urban design. Mm-hmm. And I'm not talking about urban planning, I'm talking about urban design. Mm-hmm. How do you put the squares and the places together so that they are really working for people, mm-hmm, and not just for cars and for trains and things like that? Mm-hmm. And that's more, for me, the urban planning. Mm. It's very good. I'm not saying anything against it. We just have let out this part. Mm. And so then it was decided to go in the direction of ecological settlements, because we had in the 80s, we had a lot of stuff written about settlements. Mm-hmm. And doxiadis and people like that, you know, the science of human settlements. Mm-hmm. And this was in the air, and then we thought it should go one step further in ecological settlements. It was very hard, though, to get through with it, even with this academy, mm-hmm, because they were scared of, mm-hmm, some of the stuff that we came up with.
But you actually went around and looked at best practice examples all across Europe.
That was the beginning. And, yeah. We did I think 6 or 8 examples of ecological settlements in different countries of Europe. Mm-hmm. And we did it with the architects of, mm-hmm, that settlement. Mm-hmm. And so it wasn't just, you know, somebody coming in and looking at it and observing it, that we were getting the first-hand knowledge as well. Mm-hmm. And we did 6 little books, mm-hmm, on them. So you could take Le Corbusier from Greece, and you could take this one from Germany and that one from Italy, etc. Mm-hmm. And each one was, you could almost say, a couple of months work. And to do this, we transformed we had 2 houses at that, mm-hmm, time, mm-hmm, and a house and an office, and we transformed our whole house into rooms for people to work in. Mm-hmm. And so they came and they visited us, then they went and had a look at the place with us, and then we came back and worked on it, mm-hmm, for a couple of weeks, or maybe even a month, mm-hmm, months. So, mm-hmm, so it was a build-up of these, and they're at the very beginning, just summarized, then in the beginning of the book, mm-hmm, summarized with a couple of pages each one. Mm-hmm. See? There's, for instance, was that? I can't read it upside down.
And for anybody who's listening to this, this book is freely available on the internet in the Kennedy Library, and I'll make sure to add a link to it.
Yes, I still have about something like 80 copies, mm-hmm, but it was reprinted once in English, It was only printed once in German, and really it had the effect more in English. And it was so good that the guy who was running the academy at that time, he insisted that it was written in English. This is before anybody even thought of speaking English in Berlin.
Yeah, no, but it's so important, otherwise it doesn't travel outside the German language bubble. I noticed this, that it still happens today, that there's wonderful research in Germany that doesn't make it into the English language, and vice versa.
Yeah.
But yeah, let's take a deep dive into these. At the end of basically this project, you've finish off with a chapter called A Vision for an Ecological Settlement, and it kind of summarizes the core principles that you thought should be visible in any kind of urban redesign or urban design in order to make it an ecological settlement. The first one of them is a settlement of diversity. What do you mean by that?
I mean diversity, not only in biodiversity, but a settlement with all the different elements juxtapositioned, so that you have plenty of plenty of interest, plenty of pictures, plenty of views. That we're not only just mind people, we're also eye people. We look at things, we enjoy them or we don't. And we also forget sometimes, especially with the infrastructure, we think, oh, that can be just any old thing, you know, that just has to run and work. But you can make it so beautiful.
Yeah.
I mean, okay, the Russians really went to town on their underground and made palaces of them, you could say. But others, I think, have done a really good job. And others have just made an underground, and it's very useful. You know? So, okay, but there's no joy then. And I think it's very important to have joy in life.
And part of having joy in life is human relationships and somewhat a scale that enables human interaction. So the next point that of the vision is a settlement of human scale. And since you're also a pioneer in the eco-village movement, and it's always been like this question, what is the ideal human settlement size where you can actually have true civic participation, because people's faces can actually be stored cognitively in that community's memory by everyone?
Yeah, and there is a definite connection for me between high-rise cities and crime, for instance. Our high-rise cities and making a mess of the landscape that was there already. It's just gone. It's gone completely. And then, of course, the other thing is we have then certain cities that are beautiful. I mean, I really like the city of Karlsruhe, and I really like the city of Edinburgh. But it has a certain scale. The scale is given by the rock in Edinburgh. So it's a larger scale. And then it's not only the person scale, it's the landscape scale and how these two go together.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think they've done a really good job with the Royal Mile in Edinburgh. But in other places, they've, you know, left the historical part, and then right after the historical part, you get all these,
the same copy-paste of... I mean, most of British town planning is that every town now looks the same, with the same shops, with the same designs in the high street.
The way in and the way out.
But before we go on, because you mentioned Edinburgh, and I wanted to ask that question earlier. I mean, of course, the Royal Mile and that whole old town of Edinburgh was redesigned by one of the pioneers of urban design, Sir Patrick Geddes, who was a biologist and not a town planner, because the profession of town planning didn't exist when he started. He is a co-founder of town planning. And what's so interesting about that redesign is that he was a pioneer of participatory urban renewal. He actually moved into the slums of Edinburgh, which was underneath the Royal Mile, like the Cowgate and all that, where basically the prostitutes and the lowlifes lived, and transformed it with an old trick, bringing the students in, like the starting a sort of gentrification process. So he started the first student union in the world in this area, making it cheap for students to live there, and then worked with them and the local residents to transform the entire area. And when you looked and talked to the architect,
same thing. I had him as a role model, you could say. Then it switched very quickly to the role model of Konstantinos Doxiadis, mm-hmm. who was also a person who was very much for diversity, mm-hmm. and but he was organizing the diversity, mm-hmm. all the time, and that's appealed to me, that mm-hmm. you could get the organization going, and you could really then take time to make sure that the beauty came, mm-hmm. and that you didn't leave the beauty out. And Geddes just had it in his bones, mm-hmm. What fits with each other, and yeah. still was able to get the diversity.
Yeah. And I think it's because he was a biologist, but a biologist of the old type, the Humboldt type, the naturalist type, that yeah. understood what fits together and what doesn't. He was actually working regeneratively, because he first listened to the patterns of life's ways of creating conditions conducive to life, and then he did all his other work, how he taught, how he brought intellectuals together, how he did urban planning, to fit that understanding of how life works.
And if you then the tradition went on in Scotland with Percy Jansel Marshall, mm-hmm. and with Sir Robert Matthews, mm-hmm. who both became, you could say, almost non-academicians, mm-hmm. to make sure that they were getting in design, mm-hmm. you know, and that was also quite a, I mean, they were actually the same age as me, and a little older, but mm-hmm. not very much. So I was in on their seminars, I was in on their, especially because they were also in this crowd around Doxiadis. Mm-hmm. And so we got this whole idea going of that human settlement is more than just an article worth. It's worth much more, and mm-hmm. and we have to go into it, and that we mm-hmm. really did. Mm-hmm.
So let's continue with these 12 principles, because I really feel that they're so relevant. So we've had a settlement of diversity, a settlement on a human scale, and the third one is a settlement of short distances. And this is something that is so relevant. Like, we're now talking about the 10-minute or the 15-minute block, and you get in Barcelona the super blocks where there's an urban redesign happening, trying to create exactly that, a settlement of short distances. You mentioned 1.5 to 2 kilometers.
The thing is, if we look at the medieval cities of Europe, they you could walk from one end to the other, a city, mm-hmm. within a half a day, and which meant that you could also refer to it, you could also get to know it, mm-hmm. you could get to know then the people in it, mm-hmm. and so you had a space for your life, mm-hmm. which was defined. You could go elsewhere, mm-hmm. but this was yours, so mm-hmm. you were very much more part of it, and that meant you took the responsibility.
Exactly, that's the thing.
You need to identify the
sense of belonging and connectedness to place is what actually motivates a true civic participation that is responsible and takes care of a place. Like becoming custodians of place rather than owners of place.
Yeah. That's a good word, custodians. Yeah.
And the fourth one is a settlement based on occupant responsibility, which basically leads into what we're just saying. Say a bit more, what do you mean by occupant responsibility?
Well, occupant responsibility is what I'm working with at the moment. I'm working on humus toilets, mm-hmm. which is taking responsibility for your own waste and not just pushing a button, letting it go, and to hell with it, certainly. Mm. I couldn't give a damn. Mm. Whereas I taking responsibility and making it into new earth, mm-hmm. which we can easily do and we know how to do for 100 years or more, mm. and we could be replenishing the earth, replenishing the soil, rather than what we're doing at the moment, just completely using it up forgetting about it.
Without tunneling too deeply into the detail, this is an interesting one. How would you, like in redesigning a very high density urban environment of even Berlin or some much larger cities in Asia or Africa, how would you see bringing that humanure, like closing nutrient cycles with human excrements in these cities where you, in some areas, don't have a proper sewage system, or in other areas you have a centralized sewage system that is using a lot of fresh water in the wrong way. How would you see retrofitting those kind of environments with...
There are all sorts of ways of hygienizing our feces and making them not smell immediately. One of the main points that we're pushing at the moment is the use of biochar. Mm-hmm. And biochar is a waste product of an awful lot of different things. Mm-hmm. And so if you use it in the right way and if you can get it going. And the thing is that we have not managed it with the WC. Mm. We have the most appalling biotope under the earth in a city, which is the biotope for rats, a monoculture biotope for rats, which we then keep on using, actually keep on expanding.
Yeah, because we're locked into it by past urban design instead of transforming it.
Yeah. I mean, we've forgotten things like when the WC was invented first, after about 40 years, then they had a whole system of ventilating it through the lampposts in cities. And so you'd had no smell. I mean, it's just appalling for me sometimes that I go through a European city, and then all of a sudden you get this smell of the sewers, and we're also using an awful lot of chemicals to keep that going. We use the chemicals in cleaning the toilet. We have a lot of work in keeping the toilet clean, and we have much more work than most of the humus toilets. The whole humus toilets have been thought you can do it without thinking and just do it, like the old plumsklo, I mean, you can't just take one design away and put another one in or just leave it, in certain cases you can, especially in the wild zones.
The next principle is a settlement which uses as little space as possible. That's an interesting one.
talking about that, as far as tiny houses now, mm-hmm. This is a very important thing, because in taking the space away from nature and from the wild, we then change it so much that we then have difficulties. Mm-hmm. We're making our own difficulties by building all over the place. Mm.
That's why there's a growing movement now for nature needs half, of actually rewilding large spaces in order to maintain the biodiversity that keeps the planet alive.
You know, because the permaculture was one of the few things that brought in the conscious design
of Zone 5,
the wild areas, what we call Zone 5.
Mm.
But really wild areas, right? And where you leave them alone to do their own thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, right.
And then we go on to an energy-efficient settlement, which is something that we're hearing a lot about, but it's still not happening.
And I'm talking, I was writing that in
25 years ago. Yeah.
And so it was, it's partly considered overdone then.
Mm.
That Margaret and I were saying we have to cut down on energy. We're using energy in all sorts of situations. We use energy. For instance, again, the toilet. The amount of energy that goes into the humus,
flush
the
toilet.
WC, is just amazing, and we don't even count it anymore.
Mm.
Yeah, we count what we can. Count and we bill it then, like the water, and we bill the gas and all the different other things that we use.
Mm.
But what we don't use, which is the energy of the sun, we don't even see that we can use it.
Mm.
We've got away from it.
Well,
I even say sometimes half of the architects have forgotten where the south is, where they can get the sun in and use it and transform it into all sorts of different things that we need.
I mean, it's bringing renewable energy generation straight into the city, decentralizing it, using passive solar design to work on energy efficiency, making sure that we use waste heat and not let waste heat go to waste, like central heat mains and all of that. And then it directly leads on to the next point, which is an emissions-free settlement. And again, this is really pioneering stuff, because this was in the mid-90s, and we just had COP26, and we're still not actually getting binding agreements of leaders of state to create these emissions-free settlements.
Yes, and in point of fact, since then we've created more emissions, created more things than emit.
Yeah.
So, but this is why I say really I should be the most oppressed person in this area, because of the fact that lots of things have gone to worse rather than to better.
Yeah. And this is the leads on to the next one, which is, because also I want to point out that you also already in 25 years ago highlighted that we're not just talking about carbon dioxide, we're talking about sulfur oxides and nitrous oxides and other gases too, because too often gets like we only focus on CO2 because of the carbon myopia of the current dialogue around climate change, and we're not paying attention of these other gases. But I find even more pioneering, because it opens up a whole nother conversation around the qualitative aspects of settlements that are truly healing to people, is this a quiet and a beautiful settlement. It brings two things, and it brings the sound dimensions of urban living in, which we don't pay enough attention to, and we alluded to it earlier, that we feed off beauty. We need diversity in our visual space in order to be fully creative as human beings. So,
what do you know what, that 80% of tourism is because of beauty and beautiful buildings.
Yeah.
It's just amazing. In the world, people go around to see the Taj Mahal, see the, you know, it's beautiful things that were done at huge expense, maybe even at that time.
Mm.
But it was also things that were done with a feeling of it's worthwhile because it's 20 generations will use it.
Yeah, exactly. You know, we don't build like that anymore.
Yeah. And I mean, and it's very difficult to often to get a tight client as an architect to put enough money into materials that will really last. You know, and it's the more we go in for industrial design or industrial buildings, the more we make them into decorated sheds.
That last 20, 30 years and then are in need for either pulling down or expensive refurbishment.
Well, at least it makes it easier to pull it.
But you also, in this context of a quiet and beautiful settlement, you also speak about urban design follows criteria of beauty, elegance and simplicity fitting into the existing landscape and cultural heritage of the region. And that is very much one of the core aspects of regenerative design or regenerative development is that it has to be place sourced. It has to, whatever the design expresses has to be an expression of the place and the culture and the history. It foregrounds the uniqueness of that particular place on this beautiful planet.
Yeah, I remember Christopher Day and the soul of the place. And these people were really saying something then. And this, they were inclined to forget them, that these are qualities and these are also, I mean, as I said, you know, I mean, the city of Reims lives from its cathedral, you know, and if you mess that up, then you're messing up a huge part of income.
Yeah, for so many cities. I keep thinking of Barcelona also, which is one of the last cities that is just about to complete Gaudi's Sagrada Familia. And I mean, that will, for many generations to come, bring people to Barcelona and position Barcelona. It's worth expending those kind of long-term projects. The next principle is a settlement which values water, which in a world where we already have large proportions of humanity living in water scarcity or with access to not safe drinking water, and unfortunately the water scarcity is about to increase with climate change. Again, a visionary principle for settlement design. How would you, in the context of civic participation and urban redesign, how would you get a project going in today's cities to value water in a new way?
Well, first of all, what Richard Register was doing in Berkeley, getting the streams back and out of the sewers.
Mm-hmm.
The streams have been covered over. The streams have been, some of them have been actually completely filled up.
Mm-hmm.
And how do you get, because the water and the evaporation of the water, especially in the summer, keeps the city cool.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, and you can then even use the water. I mean, why did we have all these fountains in the 19th century city?
Mm-hmm.
Just purely to keep down the heat.
Mm-hmm.
And then you know, the evaporation, you can do an awful lot with it. If you design it well, you know, like I've done with the pond in my garden, which is not only a reflecting pond for my greenhouses, but it's also an evaporation where the prevailing wind pulls the evaporation over the rest of the garden, and I don't have to water the garden.
Mm.
because of that alone. And there are, you know, really simple design systems. Mm. You know, we have gone into design in the form of fashion design. Mm-hmm. And we've made them into recipes. So then you have to have the high rise, and you have to have,
steel, glass, and concrete.
Yeah. And of course, I mean, there again, look at the whole problem that we have. People don't realize it at the moment. All these glass buildings that we've done, and the thermopane glass is only guaranteed for 10 years. Mm. Who thinks of changing the insurance policies, all the glass, to get it back to standard? Yeah. Yeah? So we don't have, not only need to have building standards, we have to have maintenance standards too.
Yeah, and I mean, with regard to water, of course, it's also about what appliances we use and how we use technology on a daily basis.
Yes.
In terms of what our water footprint really is.
Yes, and it goes into the fact of, you know, people showering twice and three times a day, maybe even every day, which is very bad for your skin. With all the different things that we use in chemicals while we're showering,
putting more stuff into the water that we then need to spend energy to get back out, or never really get back out, and then it ends up in us. Exactly. So the next one is a predominantly waste-free settlement, which again is something that we're striving towards.
We're getting nearer to that, and I think that is really a very good thing that happened in the end of the last century, this whole business of at least trying to recycle wastes and to really... So, I mean, let's say it's not all negative. There's quite a few streams of light in the distance getting us there to put a waste-free city. Why not? Mm. I mean, why can't we design even our food to be waste-free? And... Exactly.
I mean, the next principle is something that in the German context might not sound that pioneering anymore, because Germany was so pioneering in that with the Institute for Baubiologie. Yeah. But you said that the next point is a settlement of healthy buildings. Yeah. And I'm noticing that in the English world, that has only really arrived in the last few, the last decade, that people are looking more, paying more attention to building health. Mm-hmm. What aspects, apart from off-gassing and electromagnetic radiation and all that, would you include in as we do a refurbishment or retrofitting of existing urban infrastructure, what do we need to look out for in order to make buildings healthier?
Well, I mean, we can identify what... and not healthy for one reason or other. As I said, off-gassing of styrofoam, for instance, is anything up to 11 years after it's been produced. And the off-gassing even happens through the plaster work. Mm-hmm. So that's off-gassing is in many things. Even a match is an off-gassing.
Huge amount,
it immediately.
Yeah.
You notice that, so now we've changed to gas, and we do these clicky things for lighters. And we've got a whole lot of gas there. We've got everything. That's most amazing. You know, we've really gone out of the frying pan into the fire.
I often wondered when the whole zero energy house became popular in the last decade. These houses that are designed to be 100% airtight. You don't really open the windows, all automatically controlled with these air recovery systems that get the heat out of the air before you push it outside. Isn't that a death trap? Let's assume you have a high level Baubiologie, high healthy building standard designed house. If you fill it with objects that are off-gassing, a rug, a toy from a Chinese shop, or any, like most toys are off-gassing, all the chemical products, wouldn't they bioaccumulate in these houses if they're these closed loop filter systems?
Yes, you're right. I mean, where you need the tightness is in the deep winter,
mm-hmm.
or in the hot summer.
Mm-hmm.
But that's only maybe weeks on end in the usual situation. And if you can get the design right, like we have in the retrofitting of a 1938 house, that we've got the design going so that we haul in the cool air which is in the earth below.
Mm-hmm.
And we haul it in a way that it just rises and we don't even have to put in energy to haul it in.
So you use thermal ventilation in your house in a way?
We have like continual ventilation.
Which
in our
draws
house
through just through thermal.
-3 meters
uh-huh.
down below. Mm-hmm. And that in a house that was built in 1938.
Mm-hmm.
And I've now, through the photovoltaics on the roof, I'm actually making more energy than I'm using.
Mm.
And that is very expensive.
Mm.
It is nothing like expensive.
No.
It is an outlay,
yeah.
maybe. A little more outlay, but a little more savvy and design.
Mm.
And then you begin to immediately get the repay.
No, I mean, it's an investment not only into one's own financial future, but also into the health and future of many other beings, including
yeah,
exactly. our children. A settlement of native species and productive plants. I mean, that's another visionary statement about ecological urban settlements, bringing
yes.
the biodiversity
and
productive
plants.
Yeah.
How do you get all the cycles of permaculture? How do you get all the... taken for granted parts of a garden into a city.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, we have an immense amount. Actually, when you really look at the amount of space that we create in cities, we could have more garden in the city than we had before because of the balconies, because of the roofs and everything.
Mm.
Yeah. And it's not as though we don't know how to do it. I mean, we've done grass roofs and productive roots in the end of the 19th century.
Yeah.
You know, the grass roofs in Berlin that belong to 1880,
mm-hmm.
they're the houses that you don't have to do anything to because they're...
And they're better insulated.
What?
And they're better insulated, because grass roofs also add an insulation effect. But
yeah.
I'm thinking of Friedrich Hundertwasser's statement that I think is absolutely still current for urban design. In a city, every place that snow could collect on should be green.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, imagine, just if you close your eyes and imagine cities like that, then you, like, every balcony, every roof space... minimize street space, and even we could find ways to even make the areas that the traffic goes on bioproductive.
You know, Oslo has put a lot of its traffic down one story.
Mm.
And I remember the first time that my daughter, sort of about the age of 40, drove an electric car onto the urban autobahn in Berlin,
mm-hmm.
and was in this quiet space.
Mm-hmm.
And then she said, imagine all those cars there just not making any noise.
Yeah, then it,
the and cities. This should be our right.
The cities will transform.
And it's just a, it just. Yeah, city can be really transformed.
And but also like getting away from private individual transport and having electrified transport in the cities. I often think that sometimes maybe somebody's done this work. Like, is it in terms of the amount of energy we use to tunnel and build these tunnels under the street? Could we not just quieten the city streets by doing what New York did, these high-rise railways, basically. You put a structure in the middle of the street and you create a bit of shade, and underneath you can still have pedestrians, you can plant trees, you can grow food, and then traffic runs basically on the first floor.
They're flipping that over now, because they're now using the old railway lines for walking spaces, and for actually so that you can go hiking in
the High Line in New York. But I like there's a lot of areas where here in Palma where we are on Mallorca, where the only way that I could really see traffic quietening the area would be if they somehow because they can't really tunnel everything if they somehow brought traffic. Up one level, but anyway, let's look at the last two that are remaining. The last two. This one is also visionary because I'm noticing how strongly the cognitive reflex in people still is that when we're talking about ecological settlements, people don't understand ecology in the way you and I understand ecology, which makes ecology in the spirit of the person who coined the word, Ernst Haeckel, really a science of the whole and how the whole functions. That means that social and economic aspects of our daily lives are part of an ecological understanding of how it all comes together. And so in this a vision of ecological settlements, you actually, as the second to last point, say a settlement of creative conflict solving, which probably also comes from you having worked in the eco-village movement and co-created a redesign of a settlement with people.
My experience of living in an eco community in an eco village of Lebensgarten in northern Germany. Mm-hmm. And one of the very first things we did was we created a school of mediation and got Marshall Rosenberg to get us going on.
Non-violent communication.
Non-violent communication. I rather the word compassionate communication. Mm-hmm. Because non-violent is a double negative.
Yeah.
But still, to get the idea which Gandhi was looking for, you know. Mm. And if you can get that going halfway, I mean, it hasn't got to be 100%. Mm-hmm. If you can get going half or three quarters away, you just have a completely different atmosphere.
Mm.
And also much more loving situation between the people.
Right now, there's so much conversation around these. How do we redesign, as in German Quartiers in Becken, how do we redesign urban neighborhoods? And how do we involve people? It all has to be, it's now fashionable to put the word participatory in, Bürgerbeteiligung. How do you see the capacity building process in urban neighborhoods so people, A, have more of a vision of whole systems, ecological settlement design described by these principles, but also have the capabilities of conflict resolution? Because if we get people into participation without training them up in creative conflict resolution and mediation, that participation will just create the opposite of social cohesion.
It could be the other way around. That if they're really in participation, that they want to have this,
mm-hmm.
and then that they go for it.
Mm-hmm.
My problem with what planners talk about participation here is nothing is manipulation. It's nothing to do with participation.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you want to get people participating, you have to give them responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to give them positive feedbacks. Mm-hmm. And the positive feedbacks are not coming through people participating and fighting for something, fighting for the tree or fighting for the park, mm-hmm. or that sort of thing. This idea of fighting, I mean, it's also in agriculture. Mm. We fight against the pests, you know. And instead of getting the elements going, which will make the pests disappear, because that's what happens. But if you really get the balance of nature going.
If we fit in again. I mean, this is, for me, very related to the core of my work with regard to where I see working regeneratively as taking a different approach. And yeah. I think what Regenesis Group has done really well in pointing out, or Carol Sanford, is that we're stuck in this problem-solving mindset. And that problem-solving mindset leads us to sort of defining problems in abstract ways, then coming up with solutions, and then trying to scale up these solutions in any place. But if you work in a place-specific, culturally adapted, participatory way, and you work out of the potential of the individuals and the collective, human collective, and the potential of place, then you can flip this problem-solving and solutioneering practice around, and it's all about manifesting potential of that unique group of people, those unique individuals, and that unique place. Yes, and then suddenly,
and the worst thing that can happen is that then some planner or some committee comes in and turns the thing around, mm-hmm. and then you've lost everything. Mm-hmm. I saw that in Chemiseplatz in Berlin. I saw that in Dundee, when I was working in the slums there. Mm. I saw the same thing happen in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, where I worked. I was the only one that wasn't black. Mm. And they would whistle when I went through the street because I was to be taken care of, mm-hmm. because I was doing something for them. Mm. You know, and that was the positive feedback. And if you can get that sort of positive feedback going, then you can build up much, much better. Mm. And
And the last one, but definitely not the least one, a settlement of human values. And settlements and cities can be seen as collective artworks. The individual and the collective effort of many generations lend them a special, unmistakable character. Nowadays, it is possible to stimulate this historical development and make various alternatives understandable to all. For me, that is, again, so visionary, because it's speaking about place-sourced potential. It's the uniqueness of place, the uniqueness of culture. And also
the uniqueness of each person.
Human values starts with valuing humans, each individual. Yeah. And also because in this you speak about how do we build some form of consensus or agreements around how do we collectively want to live in this place? How do we want to steward this place? Mm-hmm. And everything you address is basically setting the enabling conditions for people to come together around a neighborhood, a part of a city, and say, we could shift from competitive scarcity and anonymity to collaborative abundance in this place. What's your, in terms of, in the 25 years since this was written, are you aware of any places in the world where cities have really done things that were influenced by this or that follow these principles? Does any kind of best practice come to mind?
No, I never really got all that much feedback from it, mm-hmm. because it was so, it was a very small institute, mm-hmm. although it was European. It was the sort of breakthrough wasn't really there, although the the realization was there, and the content was there, and I mean, and I have to really thank the Academy for being so open. Okay, we had a couple of problems because they didn't want to know about unseen energies like Radius disease, etc. But they came around to it, and we had the sort of feeling that there were people going, and then the other people going with us, and it did have an effect immediately on the environment in a couple of big cities that had been mentioned in it. So, and therefore, I mean, it was all too short, and it could be that, but sort it, of thing could go on much more. It can go on again.
I'm almost certain that it had a much more diffuse impact, because I know that I've written a lot of the curriculum content for Gaia Education's online course on design for sustainability, which has been taken by people all around the world in, I think, 50 countries. And one of the chapters summarizes these 12 principles. And it's interesting that I get a little bit of a, what do people feel excited about in this curriculum through having some of the material on my Medium blog. And I see how much response a piece gets when I post it. And this summary of these 12 principles always gets a very, very, like, lots of people share it. And so it just shows that it's still extremely relevant. And yeah, sometimes these things happen that it takes a while for a vision to be heard by people who haven't had... Either they don't know it exists, or they aren't there yet. And I feel like in this conversation now, how do we re-regionalize? How do we come home to place? How do we become regenerative in place again? And more people asking these questions. These 12 principles are really pioneering and will inform people for many years.
And you must think, this is the time that where the Earth Charter was formulated. And I was a little bit a part of it, in that I was in Rio Plus Five. And what's her name from Weizsäcker? She was one of the main scribes of it. And, you know, I had it under my arm going to Rio to show that there was a possibility, and there was a holistic possibility.
Yeah, I mean,
that's where people are scared of holistic possibilities.
Basically, people find, you get it, I still get it a lot, when you open up the next bigger envelope, the context, how things fit together, they feel like you're in a divergent mode and you're not getting the stuff done, and they say, give me a soundbite, and no, let's focus just on this, because then we can get it done. And that's precisely why we make such a mess. Because if we just focus on part of Humpty Dumpty, we'll never put him back together again.
Yeah.
And the whole science of healthy settlements and healthy human re-inhabitation of place is about putting a world that is an unbroken whole, but has been fractured by our way of thinking about it, back together again. And it's wonderful that you mentioned the Earth Charter at the end, because it fits very well with that last point of a science of human values. I think the Earth Charter is another one of those documents, like these 12 principles, that should get a lot more attention, because it's actually a distillation of a healthy pattern of how we can live together.
And what I want to do is, I want to take these 12 principles and put them together with the pathway to sustainability of David Holmgren, the 12 principles of permaculture, and see how good they balance out and how they can help each other. Because in point of fact, permaculture can be put onto a garden, but it can be put onto a city.
Absolutely.
It can be used as a design tool.
Yeah. I mean, I think permaculture is, again, brilliant that you mentioned this at the end of this conversation, because in your time in Australia working with Bill Mollison and David Holmgren, we've talked about this before off camera, and you mentioned to me that from your perspective, what David Holmgren really did is when he was doing his, I think it was a master's thesis, taking a deep dive into Aboriginal knowledge systems for land management and all aspects of culture, and then codifying them into a language that could be communicated to Western academics or Western practitioners.
A bit later. When he was actually doing his thesis, he was only interested really in productive elements for human consumption. And, well, no, I'm overdoing it now, because that was the starting point, you could say. And Bill was the one who had been with the Aboriginals for years, and had seen how they actually were able to come back 6 years later and find the fruit that they needed. And they knew about it, and they found it there. And that sort of thing was not just, was a knowledge that was held by word of mouth, or maybe just by...
In the landscape. Sometimes I think that Indigenous people are so attuned to how information is stored in the relationships of everything, that they then use storytelling to attune each other to those relationships, to the point that the landscape tells
them. Bill was his advisor, but he came up then with this idea that all the different elements in nature support each other. And it was only very much later that he came up with the actual codifying of them. That was when he, because he said he didn't have enough practice. When I met him first, he was 22, and he had just written it. And about a year or so beforehand, and he was, And then he said, I can't even teach it because I don't have enough practice. And so he wants to go out in the world and do things, and that's what he did. And he slowly but kept it on, even in the jobs that he got as landscape designer and all that sort of thing. He kept using these ideas and then refining them. And then he decided to do his own example, the farm that he has. It's only a 2 acre farm, but he says the same thing. If you take the average farm size in the world, it's less than 2 acres. And that's what we're feeding the people on, not on the huge areas.
But this, like, what I find so interesting about going back into that early history of permaculture is A, this, what you already highlighted, that it's a design science informed by Indigenous knowledge. So just in the same
it's
way that,
that
regenerative cultures are coming back to something that is part of our species inheritance. And this design science can help us to re-enter the regenerative evolutionary pattern of life and become, like as David Orr, one of my mentors, put it, is we need to redesign the human impact on Earth. That's ultimately...
Yes, but the thing is, the difference in that and Holmgren is that not on Earth, but on Earth where you are.
But this is exactly.
On Earth in a particular area. I mean, because the regenerative design systems in Alaska will look different than in Mallorca, you know, and that sort of...
Precisely.
So you have to bring in the identity of the place and the identity of the people in the place. And so it is very much a holistic system, and it's a holistic system for me, permaculture, where you also have the dynamite, dynamism in it. The dynamism keeps the thing going, and renews it and brings in the new ideas.
Yeah, so that's regenerative,
it's
exactly.
It never stops. The end point. Okay.
Wonderful.
Very quickly, always, and that's happened to almost every concept, it becomes recipes.
Yeah.
That's the real difficulty. And I think partly the computer is the problem here, because you have to have definite yes and no's in the computer to make it work in the series. And whereas here you have to have sometimes changes all the time. Okay, it's slowly getting the dynamism.
Well, basically it is like it blows up your project if you don't pay attention to the dynamism. Like, so it is dynamite if you don't pay attention to dynamism. No, because I think that one of the common misconception even of permaculture students, because of the high, show me your site design, is that they hold on to this site design, what they've planned, how they were going to do everything, as if it's something to be implemented and then maintained rigidly, rather than really using the dynamism and using the principles as guidance on a journey. So you're constantly redesigning your design because the feedback is telling you how to tweak it and how it
needs
evolving.
That's why I think his name of the book, Pathway to Sustainability, is the pathway. It's not the definite design. And the pathway is always changing, you know?
That's what we need to learn. I think we're tired. We've got it. Thank you.